Hello, thank you for attending, and thanks all previous speakers for the good presentations. Our presentation is entitled Social Operating Framework, and but before I go there, I'd like to ask a question. First of all, did you all write open source software? Which of you are writing as developers of open source software? Those of you who are writing open source software, can you share with us a couple of things that are making your life difficult with open source? I mean, when it's not your own code, when you're working with someone else's code. I have a couple of. No?
I can say very poor documentation.
Yeah.
It's hard when you have to deal with too many projects, and sometimes you have to present the code on different codes. If you are written, for example, different programming languages, it makes it hard to switch contexts when you are dealing with different projects in different languages.
Okay, and another question as well, presentation. Which of you have ever problem with deciding which license is right for which software? Okay, so I made this question because with this work we're trying to propose a more holistic way of looking and evaluating open source software. Of course, when we started this work, we didn't know how a big sector would be attacking, at least not what we thought. And so, as you're going to see, as we were working more questions were arising, and I think it's a very good beginning of a great research field, which I hope we can all contribute to make it better. So, also, I did research for this work, and also with Mr. Nellis, he helped co-author the paper, and I want to thank him about remembering and giving some great thoughts on paper. So, I'm coming from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, it's in the north of Greece. You can see in the picture below and in the picture above, it's a view of my city, Thessaloniki, where the university resides. Our research group, the one head of which is Professor Nellis, is software engineering group, and we're dealing mainly with open source software-related issues and research fields. And we'll be happy to cooperate with you if you want on an academic or another level. So the motivation of our publication was that right now, open source software is being used in research and in industry in two main ways. One is assets. We're taking open source software and we're working with it. We're using it, changing it, or just installing it into stuff, like for example, Linux operating system. Or we're using the part of it to make our code better. Let's say an open source library, component, or whatever. There are several process quality models in the literature suggesting ways we can measure open source software and evaluate it. But some of them are seeing the structural quality component of the model. Others go further and take into consideration the community, health, activity, software governance. But to our best knowledge, there is no universal acceptable assessment model. So we thought that we try to propose something like that by utilizing a model from another research field, which is architecture and urban planning, which is called the Citizen Framework. And I'm going to explain later what's that and how it works. So here are some references on aspects of software we find in literature when we try to evaluate open source. As I said earlier, we define those models, stability, maturity, community licensing business, maybe options like business model, open source, stuff like that. We propose that to approach an open source project, we need to see it as an evolving system and not just the snapshot of code for the specific commit we're seeing. I mean, and what I mean by that is that we need to try and look the open source software as it evolves in time with the characteristics of its history. In order to be able to study it in a holistic way. Also, for an open source software, in order to be good in the future or become better in the future, it is crucial to be resilient in order to survive the test of stresses and crises, and we're going to see some examples of that in the following slides. So, what could be a crisis or a stressor for an open source software? It could be, for example, that a fork of the project draw the attention from the initial project and people migrate there. And I'm not only talking about developers, but also end users as well. So it's not being used as it used to be. Another one is migration of lead developers. It's something that we've seen in major open source software projects like OpenOffice with LibreOffice and other stuff. If it be an unsuccessful major release, that might hurt the reputation project. At some point, a major release goes with a lot of bugs, and people are starting to abandon the project. Or, if it be migration, another fault. And I thought about the deliverables example. So, what's resilience? I've got here a couple of definitions from various research fields in order to gradually go to what we found that can be used in software. So we have from logistics, the ability of the system to cope with change. From software, a really old work, it's 2009 if I'm not mistaken. A resilient system can take its physical component and recover and come back for more in a long, bounded, and generally acceptable period of time. And the one that to which we based our research comes from the Arab Institute that created the Citizen Framework with their federal institute, which is Citizen describes the capacity of cities to function so that the people living and working in cities, particularly the poor and vulnerable, survive the time and not have less source of income. This is from the urban planning research area. So, in order to be able to tell you what we did with open source, I'll go very quickly through the security framework. They created the framework and then they based an index for evaluating cities on this framework, and I'm going to go straight away to the index, which is more helpful for our case. The city resilience index will measure relative performance over time. So that's where we get our what I was talking about earlier was that we need to be able to evaluate the software over time. So this seems to work for us. It will not deliver an overall single score for comparing performance between cities. Indeed, it's not our end goal to compare and contrast two specific open source software systems, but we need to see what a specific open source software project, how it's being evolved over time, and how good and in which are its strengths and its weaknesses. Neither will provide a world ranking of the most resilient cities. Again, in our case as well, we don't want to make a top 10 of best open source software systems, we just need to see if the open source systems with which we're working are good for us and for our needs. The Citizen Resilience Framework has this structure. It defines four dimensions. Each dimension has goals, and each goal has some indicators. very quickly. The four dimensions for this is in the framework is health and well-being related to people, economy, society related to the organization of cities, infrastructure and environment related to place, and leadership and strategy related to knowledge of the past and adapting appropriately to the future. And in its slide, the slide will be available to create forms so you can take it and see it at your own time. The goals under that are being explained. So, open source software business framework, we took a similar approach. We actually tried to adapt the citizen framework to our needs. Where did the open source software projects set a conceptual similarity with cities? Why is that? They are also dynamic and continuously evolving systems with their own structural properties. We know that from literature, it's been said from other colleagues over the years. They attract people that form communities around them with some second level, they utilize the governance model. There's also research about the governance models in open source. Some open source projects have commercial activity, so we have business and license things to go there. And as it's happening with cities, OSS projects can face stresses and crises, which was some of them earlier. So we adapted the model, and we also have four dimensions, 12 goals, and some indicators. Because of the length of the framework, it wasn't possible to depict it all at the limited pages that we had to work for a specific conference. So we're going to see the four dimensions and their goals, and as the indicators are concerned, we're going to see a portion of them. So, dimensions and goals. Dimension number one for us is the source code. If we see the citizen framework, the first dimension is health and well-being, and it's related with people. Being the structural unit of a city, we define the structural unit of an open source software to be the source code, for example, classes, packages, components, or whatever suits the designer or researcher. So for us, it is source code. For the business and legal dimension, this is our second dimension. Again, in this business framework, we have economy in society, which is related to the organization of the city. We, in open source software, although the norm is voluntary work, more mature projects are utilizing open source business models, and therefore this dimension for us is related with business and license related things. Third dimension is integration and reuse. For the citizen framework was related to place, and for us it's similar because if an open source project is easily integrated in other systems, then it can find its place to a new software and become part of it. Or if we think of it vice versa, if we want for our project a reusable component, we can search to another open source software, get it ready, and adapt it to our system, as opposed to another saying earlier with this presentation. And finally, the fourth dimension is the social dimension, the community around the open source software. The last dimension of the citizen framework is about leadership and strategy. It's related to utilizing knowledge from the past to become better and more resilient in the future. In open source software, both leadership and strategy aspects are related to the community, and I have a note there that knowledge base for our case in the open source software could be the code base itself, the control versioning system, the issue tracker. We heard in the previous presentation the findings from certain projects that were closed and then they were open. So, in this part, we're going to see the goals. For the source code dimension, we have three goals, as it is with this solution framework. It's continuous growth, holistic documentation, and systematic testing, evaluation, and optimization. In business and legal dimension, we have economic sustainability, flexible licensing, and external organization support. This is the dimension that we're going to see to the very end in this presentation and see an example of how we use the framework in this dimension. The third dimension is integration and reuse. We have low developability, low complexity and ease of integration. And the fourth is social community dimension, well-defined project standards, well-defined governance, and developer-based activity. I want to note here that for most of those goals and the indicators that we're designing, there is underlying research. We're not discovering the wheel from the beginning. We're going to base our research there, get the metrics that help us to create the framework in the best way, and if we don't have that, maybe then we don't design our own. We don't need to do research over again. We need to also utilize what's happening right now. So about the indicators. The third goals are federalized indicators. So up to now we have four dimensions, each of us three goals, so we have 12 goals. Each of them is federalized indicators. As I said, these specifications, we weren't able to give them all to this specific publication, but we have a preliminary report online in this URL. You can go and see them all, or at least the version, the current version. For now, we're going to see the bits a little dimension in bigger detail, so as to show you how this whole thing works. So the indicators for the digital dimension are attached to a goal, and if we go to the first goal, we will remember that it is the economic sustainability. What are the indicators there? We have donations, so does an open source project accept donations or not? Because it is a way for revenue stream. Also, do we have commercial features? So is there a version or a part of the open source software that it is commercially used and there are economic benefits of that? And then we have support. Does somebody for this open source software pay for support or not? So for those three indicators, if the answer is no, we have zeros. If the answer is yes, we have ones. We're going to see how we're using them in a while. The second goal is flexible licensing. We have two indicators here. The one is level of permissiveness. There is research that proposes that unrestricted types of licenses are a barrier in some cases for using open source software or for using open source software for commercial purposes. So, when we're talking about non-restricted license, we're actually talking about a license for closed software. In the middle, we have a persistent license, which is GPL, for most of you who know licenses. And we also have permissive licenses like the PSD. For this indicator, we have given them the values that you see there. And we paste this indicator to the to a publication that you can find in our references in the paper. Second indicator, letter of persistence, saying if there are parts of the project that are licensed with a persistence license. Why we care about that? Because if we have persistence license in software, then if we're using the source code of the software, then our source code also needs to be under a persistent license, which in some cases, as I said earlier, can be hard for our project.
What's a persistent license?
GPL. So when you're building code, your own open source software, and you're using part of another open source software written in GPL, you also need your project to be strictly in GPL or GPL compatible licenses. This can be bad in some specific types of projects. We're not saying that the GPL license is bad, I need to clarify that, just that it might not be what we need in some specific cases in open source. The third indicator is the external organization support. So if the project is just a community effort, or it's backed from a non-profit, for example, or for-profit organization that helps it become better and more. Okay, so now that we have the dimensions, goals, and indicators, we need a way of deciding whether a project is resilient or not. And to do that, we need a resilience determination mechanism so that to be able to say in which dimensions we have resilience and to be able to decide if the whole project is resilient. So we're starting to the lowest level, which are the indicators, the KPIs, and we, using the numbers that I was saying, we're trying to determine whether this indicator is resilient or it helps the project to be resilient. Then we move up to dimension 11. Sorry, then we move up to the goals 11, and we sum up our results from the indicators. And if 50% of them are resilient, then we consider the project resilient. Again, as we're going to say later, this is threat to validity, but we need to start from somewhere, and we selected 50% to be this threshold for now. Maybe it will change in the future, should we have the research that backs it up. Likewise, on the project level, the upper level, we sum up the findings on the goals level, and if 50% sums up to a resilient project, then the whole project is resilient. Otherwise, it's not. I'm going to finish the presentation with a couple of examples. We try to apply this framework to two projects that we thought empirically that fall to the categories of resilient and non-resilient, I'm going to explain, and see if our framework will give us the same results that we intuitively thought we should get. So the first one is a project named OKAPI. It is a framework for building, a basic framework for building web applications. It was started in 2008 and never wasn't updated after 2011. So we could consider this project an abandoned one, or at least a deprecated project. We selected this case in order to test our framework and the project that intuitively seems more resilient. So these are the versions. The way we selected the versions because there are a lot of major release candidates, beta, alpha versions. We decided to take the last major version of this year in order to be able to have a sense of the time evolution of the project. So this specific project has three milestones, one in 2008, 2009, 2013, the end of the year, respectively.